would like to introduce Mr. Meghraj Gore, Vice President Operations at Fortis Healthcare Limited India. Sir is a seasoned global professional with more than 18 years of versatile experience in business management in North America, Asia, and Africa, with a particular focus on healthcare for the past 14 years. He has played a key role in the phenomenal growth of Fortis in becoming one of the leading players in India. Sir has led business transformation and financial turnaround of publicly listed as well as private healthcare companies in India, Mauritius, and Vietnam.
I request sir to kindly address the audience.
Good morning, everyone. When I was asked to speak on this topic, I wasn't sure how many people will be in the audience. I'm completely aware of how much healthcare professionals love numbers, financials, medical and non-medical, but I'm very happy to see so many delegates here. You have a wonderful campus. There's something about being on college campus. There's always some energy buzz, which you can feel even if you're not studying. And I'm happy to feel that positivity here. I'm supposed to talk about financial planning for a sustainable hospital. I will try to make it as non-financial and as interesting as possible. There are three keywords in this. One is sustainable. Sustainability in this context, one can define as managing three bottom lines: financial, social, and environmental. That's profit, people, and planet. Today, we'll talk about mostly on financial bottom line and little bit on social bottom line. We'll leave planet, environment for, you know, next time. Financial planning, if your objective is to achieve three bottom lines, financial planning is a process where you make smart decisions with the resources that you have to achieve these three bottom lines in a financially savvy manner. First step of financial planning is assessing external environment. So let's start with that first. This is our last 12, 18 months that industry has faced. We've been pretty much slapped around, literally and figuratively, for last 12, 18 months. So much so that the most popular topic in healthcare conferences today is, are we sustainable? I don't think there is anything bad or unusual in this. We are a relatively new industry as an organized sector. This is part of maturity curve. We have finished our teenage education. Now we are getting into a real life. So facing these kind of issues is not very different than other industries or what happens in real life. In cricket language, it's like we've been scoring centuries on flat wickets in domestic circuit in Ranji matches, and now we are playing in the big league on South African, Australian bouncy green wickets. So some of these issues that we are facing, I think, are not necessarily bad. Part of it is just perception that we have to handle. Part of it's something that we need to improve. And if we do that, we'll come out as much better, stronger. While this is the present, and I know a lot of my colleagues and within my organization and outside have very strong feelings about this. We felt, you know, that it's unfair, it's depressing. I want to take you through what we have achieved in the past. Private healthcare story in Indian economy is one of the most remarkable stories in development of India. 70% of beds that we have added, hospital beds, in last decade have been added by private sector. If you look at population, they have a choice to go to free public healthcare, but 60% of population prefers to go to private sector, pay out of pocket at times, because they get value for money, they get convenience, they get outcomes, they get quality in those setup. It's not just Indians. 2016, more than 4 lakh foreigners came to India. They had a choice to go anywhere in the world, Europe, US, but they came here because they felt that the value for money they get at a level of quality in India is unbeatable compared to any other country. Talking about quality, right? These foreigners are not coming for simple procedures. They are coming right from cosmetics to IVF to cardiac, neuro, ortho, cancer treatment, transplants. These are not simple procedures, right? These are life-saving procedures, and they still choose to come to India when the first thing they get out of the airport see is cows on the street, bad roads, etc., but they still have faith in us. Talking about quality, few years ago, those of you who work in hospitals, when we applied for NABH, we used to shout from top of our hospitals that we are NABH accredited, because that used to be a differentiator. That's a national accreditation body. It's a stamp of quality. We used to shout from the top of the roof. Today, there are about 520 hospitals in India which are NABH accredited. Out of those, 9 are government, and everything else is in the private sector. But think of it. Today, we're having a discussion that to get insurance empanelment, to get government scheme empanelment, NABH is a basic minimum criteria. So what was a differentiator just a few years ago has become a basic common denominator or requirement. And for a young industry, that's a huge jump that we have taken. Make in India is a flavor of this administration. I don't know how many of you know, but in 2016, India imported $3 billion worth of medical goods and services into the country from outside. In the same period, we exported $14 billion worth of goods, medical goods and services. That's an $11 billion surplus that healthcare industry has given to India in 1 year. That's higher than any mid-low income level country. In fact, that's the fourth highest in the world for healthcare sector. The three countries that are higher than us are Germany, Switzerland, and Ireland. We are one of the largest providers of employment, especially for women. I have, in hospitals that I manage, we have 5,000 workforce. 60% of those are women. They make us better, right? So if you consider this list, all of us, no matter what we are going through right now, need to be really, really proud of what we have achieved so far. Once in a while, you get out on a first ball, doesn't mean things are bad. That just means that we have to go back to the drawing board, go back to our practice pitch, and work on things that we need to refine. So if this is the present, that's the past, what about future? Because I believe, you know, we are in an educational institute which is training future professionals. What about future? It's a lot of data on the slide. Just go with what I'm saying. This basically says that incidence of communicable disease is going to keep growing up in India. That means more and more people, Indians, are going to need medical treatment. This basically says that everything that is happening on a technology front, whether it's smartphones, mobile health, telemedicine, wearables, Fitbits, etc., literacy, awareness about health, more and more people are going to get diagnosed. Not just diagnosed, but they're going to get diagnosed earlier in the continuum of the care. If under Ayushman Bharat, if the government does what they are saying, we'll have 1.5 lakh health and wellness centers across the country. Now what happens? Again, more and more people get diagnosed. So demand for healthcare services is only going to go up. Cost has been a flavor of the year. I feel that the problem we have is not that our costs are high, and the foreigners who come can vouch for that. It's that the problem is not about cost, the problem is about how we pay for the treatment. Because we have to pay out of pocket, because there is no insurance cover, it pinches us more than a lot of other countries, right? So let's look at this. Not only middle class is growing, but the size of their wallet is growing. So more and more people are going to be able to afford healthcare. This talks about insurance coverage in India. So right now, 2010-11, we had 75% of population which was uncovered and 25% covered under different categories of insurance. In 5 years, 25% became 37%, 5 years, right? 63% of 1.3 billion population is uninsured. But you know what? Finally, we have a government which has an ambitious healthcare agenda. Now, we all have concerns whether they'll be able to implement it, do it on time, but at least they have a huge, huge vision. What happens if they're able to do that? If 50 crore people, 10 crore families get covered under National Health Protection Mission, 38% of population moves in this category. That means only 27-odd% population is uninsured. Now imagine what happens when the incident disease burden goes up, detection increases, and affordability or ability to pay goes up. The demand for healthcare services goes up. All of us have a bright future, correct? Now, there are still few, you know, things that we need to figure out in future. This is a 2004 data, 2014 data, and a WHO recommendation. We have added in 14 years from 2000 to 2014 about 4 lakh doctors, and we need to add another 4 lakh just to get to WHO recommendation of 1. Similarly, we've added 10 lakh nurses in 14 years, we need to add 8 lakh nurses. Now, just to give a perspective on what this means, in 14 years, we added 4 lakh doctors. Today, we have about 53,000 MBBS seats in the country, 22,000 seats for post-grad. And if you go to super specialization, about 79 seats for cardiac surgery for 1.3 billion people. Now, 54,000 MBBS graduates. Some of them will go abroad. Some of them will become management. Some of them will become start working in pharmaceutical. So the actual doctors who will be practicing is going to be much lesser than that. Same for post-grad, right? So if we have to add 3.5 lakh doctors, which is if we just take MBBS at a 50,000, you know, we'll take 5 to 7 years, you know, 7 to 10 years to reach that number. Now, government is saying today there is an announcement that they're going to set up X number of AIMS and all. But by the time they build everything, will be first batch comes out, it will be 8 to 10 years. So we have a problem. Why is it important to understand? Because everything we're talking about today, on the first slide we saw, the nursing cost, we must pay more to nurses. I sincerely believe that we must pay more to nurses because they do the most of the care part than anyone else in healthcare. They are underpaid and we need to fix that. So when our costs are increasing, okay, when competition is growing, you're going to have a fierce battle for the same talent, doctors, nurses, medical professionals, healthcare professionals. What happens? It drives up the cost. That gets compounded when we have a shortage like this. So next 5-8 years, we're going to have a problem with our manpower cost going up. Let's look at beds. We've added 8 lakh beds in 14 years. We have to add 10 lakh beds to get to the norm. 10 lakh beds doesn't put it in perspective, but if you say you need 10,000 hospitals of 100 beds or 20,000 hospital nursing homes of 50 beds, then you understand the magnitude of what we need to do. And this doesn't take into account the previous slide where the demand is growing up, the capacity is going up. There's another problem that we have. This is the data of different Indian states. Maternal mortality rate. We have states in our own country where 200 more mothers die giving a birth than few others compared to few other states. 50 more infants die than compared to Goa in Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh. Just based on where you live, a fellow Indian may have a 10-year less life expectancy than, you know, compared to Kerala, Maharashtra. That doesn't sound right, right? There's a gap. We know most of us would like to work in metros and cities. Most of us would like to send our kids in schools in metro cities. So we have a problem. We have a problem that, yes, we want to be in cities, but we need to take care of people who are not in the cities. And I'll tell you a story on why this is important. A few months ago, I landed in Delhi and took one of those radio cabs. The driver was Imran, and I started talking, and we left the airport, and he said, Saab, cash hai ya wallet, e-wallet? So I said, e-wallet. He said, sir, cash chahiye tha. I said, why? I asked the guy at the counter airport. He said, it's okay to pay by the e-wallet. He said, sir, paise nahi hai. I said, what do you mean? He said that I bought this car from the company, and till they deduct my entire EMI for a month, I don't get any cash in hand. So I have to do all the sawaris till you pay to the company that, you know, whatever monthly installment is, and then I start. So I said, how do you pay for diesel, you know, your family? He said, yeah, I have to request passengers to not use e-wallet. So I said, what about your family? He said, sir, I breakfast, lunch, dinner is at Gurdwara till I get some cash in hand. Very nice guy, educated, clean, car was nice. And then he said something that has stuck with me. He said, saab, log bolte, tisra mahayudh pani pe hoga. He said, mere hisab se na, ye garib aur shrimanton ke beech mein hoga. And when I think of it, lot of what we faced in last 12, 18 months is a reflection of that. Lot of what you're seeing, radicalism, extremism, this propensity to be violent, be, you know, loud on every issue, is this pent up frustration of lot of people who are not in as good a position that we are in, are feeling frustrated. So for any business to be sustainable, as long as there is such a vast disparity between haves and have-nots, you cannot be sustainable. No foreign investor will invest in a country where there is such an underlying social unrest. So we need to fix it, right? This is something that even if we are for profit in health private setup, we have to keep that in mind. We all know that how consumers are evolving. Previous speakers spoke about, it's no more God, doctor is God. I'm a paying consumer. I want timely service, convenience, etc. I want to participate in my decision making about my own health. All this, we are aware of it. To be frank, we've not kept pace with the increasing expectations of our patients. And that's a problem, and that's something that we need to fix. So obviously, we can't continue the way we are running our business so far. We need to change. Okay, we need to change, because otherwise we will be irrelevant in the marketplace. We will cater to customer that is no more the same customer and evolved into something else. So what's the imperative? That we all need to have a stronger, sharper business acumen. Okay, what does it mean? That resources will be always finite, forever, right? So when the marketplace, the external environment, is evolving at such a rapid pace, You need to be aware of it, you need to have an understanding of it, and you need to have an ability to make quick decisions to change yourself so that you respond to the changing customer and still continue to be profitable. That involves, you know, first, we cannot run away from numbers and finances. That pays for all our salaries. So we must, you know, learn about those. We have to have a clear strategy, and I'll elaborate later on. We need to have financial planning. We need to review our performance on a periodic basis. We need to balance short-term, long-term. We need to balance quality and cost. In general, we need to be more financially savvy in how we operate. There are five things, if I have to talk about five fundamentals of finance or business planning, these are the five things that have helped me so far. First, patient satisfaction. That's the reason why certain patients choose one hospital over other. But apart from everything, if we don't do that, we won't survive. So that's a key. It's not a financial parameter, but everything that we do it for them, and they pay for everything that we do, and therefore that has to be the top priority. Growth. Growth can come in different ways in hospitals, right? So you add a doctor, add a specialty, add a equipment, add a sub-specialty, introduce a new procedure, tie up with a particular institute, go to different market. There are several ways of growth. But we need to understand what's a good growth and a bad growth for in your context, in your business context, and make smart decision about how to grow. Let me give you an example. This is an appraisal period, those of you who are working, right? You probably have gone through performance review. You're probably expecting an increment. And your employer comes and HR comes and says, okay, you did fantastically well. You got this percentage of increment. This is your letter. And then you see it. And when you look at when money comes in your bank, you see that the amount that you got is less than what you used to go. Why? Maybe different reasons. You change your tax bracket. They change the structure. But what? How do you feel? You got a growth. But what you got in hand is not. Good growth and bad growth, we need to understand. Cash. Again, you got salary slip, but you not got money in your account. Cash, I'm using it for liquidity, liquid funds, right? You can't, the taxi driver, can't. He's got a revenue. He's booking the revenue, but he's not getting anything in hand. He can't pay for diesel. He can't, you know, he has to beg, borrow. He has to go to Gurdwara to eat. Cash, importance. Gross contribution. Again, one of the most important things we need to learn, because 38% of population is going to get into government scheme. They're going to come with CGHS or CGHS minus rates. And therefore, you need to figure out how you protect your gross contribution. Gross contribution is basically you buy something for 100 rupees and you sell it for 105 rupees. 100 was your cost, 105 was your revenue, 5 rupees is your gross contribution, right? Velocity. Let me tell you about this story. Again, it's probably the most underappreciated financial concept in healthcare. Velocity. So there is a very famous story which I heard from my professor. Is a smart MBA in suit boot like me once went into an educational tour into a developing country. Studying micro-lending. So went into a marketplace, was talking to a shopkeeper, vendor, and thought he's asking smart questions. So asked, so how do you raise the capital? The guy said, I took a loan. What's your interest rate? He says, 2% per month. He says, 2% per month? Wow, that's a 24% interest for a year. He says, what's your margin on your what you're selling, the goods? He says, 4-5%. So I said, 4-5% margin on goods, 24% annual interest rate. He says, are you making money? He says, yeah, about 25-26%. Now, the smart MBA is saying, has a perplexed look. So he looks at vendor, and vendor figures out what he's going to ask. And he does this. That's velocity. So you buy goods of, let's say, 100 bucks. You take 100 rupees on loan. You have a 1 year period. You sell the goods, make 4-5%. Then again, you sell it 4-5%. You do it 10 times, you have 40-50 rupees saved, right? Your interest cost is 24. You still have 25-26 rupees saved. That's called asset turnover. Okay? Why this is important? Because our margins are going down. We'll have to go into volume business. And therefore, how fast we turn the patients around, how we reduce our average length of stay is going to be key going forward. So with those financial concepts out of the way, let's change the track. So we were doing a task. We were lifting a burden of the business as management professionals. That had changed now. The burden has become huge. We can't lift it and take it. We have to still move it. So we need levers, right? You don't have to lift it. You need levers. You need business levers. What do business lever means? Let's get to our national pastime, cricket. Since he started it, that's the flavor of the month. Who can tell me which is the most successful international one-day cricket team, country, and period? History of one-day cricket. Australia, which period? West Indies in 70s and 80s, but they won 2 World Cup in a row. 99 to 2007, Australia won 3 World Cups in a row. Now remember this period, we had big fours. Tendulkar, Dravid, Ganguly, Lakshman. Then we had Sehwag coming in. We had Jumbo, Anil Kumble. Person to person, we had a solid team. If you look at their career records, you won't probably remember other than Steve Waugh, Ricky Ponting, anyone in that team. But they won 3 World Cup in a row. Coach was John Buchanan. And his philosophy was this. He was a maverick. Okay. Now, game of one-day cricket, as all of you know, there is one thing you have to do to win. You have to score more runs per over than the other team. Right? So run rate per over is the key parameter. For a team, it's run rate per over. For an individual batsman, it's a strike rate. Number of balls faced and number of runs scored. Right? So if you have more than 100% strike rate, okay, the team will score, you know, more than 300 runs because 50 overs, 6 balls, 300 balls. Now, John Buchanan felt that everything that we track one-day performance is rubbish. These are lag indicators. They are outcomes. They don't help me on how to improve the performance. Now, if you remember those days, cricket used to be played in a different way. First 15 overs, you had a field restriction, you hit out. 15 to 40 overs, you consolidate, you don't lose wicket, you don't take risk, you rotate, you know. And last 10 overs, you again slog, right? Now, Buchanan thought that that way of managing the performance of the team is rubbish. So this is what he thought. So a run rate or strike rate of a batsman is a simple ratio. Number of runs scored as a numerator and number of balls faced as a denominator. Now, all of us intuitively think that, yeah, we need to take more singles, more doubles, fours, sixes. He said, forget that. Let me focus on the denominator. Number of balls faced. He figured out that there are so many dot balls. Even if I score one run on a dot ball, that's 100% strike rate for that dot ball. So this is what he did. First, he brought the concept that one-day team doesn't have to be the test team. There is a different skill requirement, and therefore, you need fitter, you know, stronger, faster players. So he got those kind of player. Michael Bevan was a pillar in one-day team, not necessarily in a test team. Then he made them fit, made them run hard so that they can steal a single, even if the ball is in close proximity. Then he studied every batsman. Every batsman is either Ganguly was God on offside, you know, so have some strength. They're natural areas. That's where they'll score runs. It's the other areas that you don't score runs. That's why you have dot balls. So he started player by batsman, thinking how do you play softly the balls which are not in your area of strength and still rotate the strike. You didn't need power. You just need to find the gaps and just rotate the strike. He also taught them how to run fast and better coordination. Okay? He did something else. He said that I need faster and better fielders. So 10-15 runs saved is going to, you know, make a difference. Now you think our players, you know, that time, how fit they were and why. That's the reason why they won 3 World Cups in a row. Things changed when we started getting Mohammad Kaif and, you know, Yuvraj Singh, who were fitter players, and Dhoni, and, you know. Now you look at Indian team and every guy who comes in is a great fielder. You know? But it took us. That's the guy who started it. Why am I talking about this? Because in financial world, we review our business with a P&L. These are all lag indicators. What we need is business levers, which are lead indicators. If we track them on a day-to-day basis, it helps us to improve our performance. No point in looking at lag indicator at the end of the year, month, and say that, oh, we didn't perform. You need to have a real-time tracking of how you're performing. So for example, revenue can be footfalls, you know, how many OPD patients come, how many of them get diagnosed and still come to you for inpatient conversion, what kind of pricing we have, what kind of channel mix we have, cash, TPA, government business, private players, PSUs. That can be net revenue. For direct cost, it could be, which is drugs and consumables, which is cost per item and quantity of items used. Now, I'm giving this as an example, but you can go much deeper. Now, with 200 more items coming under a DPCO price control in last couple of years, cost per item is no more a lever that is available for us, and the value that we get is going to diminish. But I have seen, when we mapped 3 years ago, all the cardiac surgeons in the country, there was a cardiac surgeon who was doing a CABG at 45,000 rupees cost, and there was a cardiac surgeon who was doing a 25,000 cost. We mapped their outcomes, no difference in the outcomes. Why? We went in. We found all kind of things. Someone was so judicious, used to cut the sutures, still use. Someone had a different technique. There are already people existing in our systems who know how to do it better. It's just that we don't know it, right? So you can go to a very fine detail level to figure out how to improve your performance. Now, let me introduce the most complex concept in today's presentation. It won't get more complex. You will hear at some point of in your career, when you deal with investors, this term called ROCE. It's return on capital employed. In layman's language, it's a ratio of two things. One is returns as a numerator and capital employed as a denominator. Basically, it means if I put in 100 rupees in hospital, how much returns I have got out of it. Why do you need it? Because investor doesn't have to invest in hospital. They can invest in food, restaurant, hotels. They can invest in any other industry. They can even keep it in the fixed deposit and earn whatever 9-10%, 8-9% interest on that. So they have choices. In the end, you may have a 20% profit margin, but if return on capital employed is not higher than their other options available to investors, they won't invest in your business. So it not only takes your profit margin in consideration, but also take the investment. And for a hospital business, which requires very high investment in the beginning, this is probably the most appropriate ratio, and that's why you'll hear this ratio a lot. Returns is a function of what you earn, what you spend, and a difference between them. There's an X factor, patient experience, which it's a financial presentation, but that's again probably the most important, because if you do this right, and if you do the right thing always for the customer, you don't have to worry as much about these things. Capital employed is basically how you build your hospital, how much you invest in it. That's CapEx. And what kind of business model is there? Talking about business model, if you look at all healthcare chains today, they all say two things. We have world-class clinical service, clinical excellence, and we have the most compassionate patient care. You go to their hospitals, you won't see any difference. If you ask customers, they won't be able to tell you difference of between one hospital and another. So we're all in many ways clubbed in the same category. There's no differentiator, right? We all try to do everything. Okay? These are the different models that are available today. And there could be combinations of all these factors. But this is just a traditional way of thinking. This is not the OLAs or OYO. Now imagine someone like OYO comes and says, all these hospitals, nursing homes have these beds free. Let me tag it under healthcare OYO and I will become a marketplace. Not an unimaginable scenario. Why is this important? Because everything that you do has to be revolved under what your strategy is and what business model you are going to build around it. Your business model will tell you what kind of hospital, how much you invest. So location, what kind of building, vertical, horizontal, what kind of medical equipments. There are other industries who've done it beautifully. When the budget hotels came, what did they do? They said that we won't go as much vertical. Okay, we will remove porch, we will remove lobbies, we will remove number of hospitals, number of restaurants, but above the lobby level, everything will be same, right? So there are other industries who done it beautifully. Medical equipment, I can't imagine why we do 64 slice, then I get 128, then someone gets 256. It's like iPhone. 7, 8, 9, 10, and we are suckers because we buy it, right? Do you know all the functionality? No. Do you use all the functionality? No. But that's your personal choice. When you buy a 256 slice CT scan, you pay a bomb, you probably use it for minor percentage of patients, but you spread that cost on all patients. This is where I was very happy when I heard about Three Netra, the gentleman who was talking about. Amazing work. Combine 5 expensive imported machines into one machine at a fraction of cost, make it mobile, and this is what we need. Let me talk about efficient execution. Another low-hanging fruit. If your project gets delayed, which most projects do, by a year, your return IRR, internal rate of return, will drop by 3% for every year. Right? So what is already difficult, you're going to make it difficult. Now, I've marked this red. These are the revenue levers and cost levers. And these are, your CapEx, capital employed levers. Now, the red ones are where we are feeling we are going to face a lot of pressure. We're not going to have much opportunity there. Okay? But let me talk about utilization and productivity. I'm sure all of you have seen at a toll booth, there is a guy who stops you. There's a guy who takes cash, there's a guy who prints, there's a guy who gives you, and the guy who raises the thing. Only in India it can happen. When you can have a smart card and you can just zip through without any intervention. Hospitals are run the same way. There are a couple of guards at the entrance, a couple in front of lobby, one inside the lift, one outside the lift. Why? Hotels have done it. Public floors, you go. Residential floors, unless you swipe your board, you swipe your card, you can't. Why can't we do it? There's a hotel chain which did it beautifully. They said, I want to cut my cost. I'm going to hire 2 experienced people in place of 3. Pay them higher than the market so I get talent and drive the productivity and get a better job done than others. Now, why can't we do it? Okay? We have done it already. Okay? Look at cardiac surgery versus PTCA. What used to take 4 hours takes 1.5 hour, where patient used to stay 9 days, stays for 3 days, and now with the stent capping, it's 1/3 of the cost, right? So we have done it, open surgery. We'll have to think about all those things. You can't just build a hospital because it's your dream, your father's dream, your wife's dream. You want to marble this, that. You have to have a business strategy. You need to identify what's your core segment, and you have to come up with a business model that caters only to that core segment. Then you can run away to the bank with truckloads of money. Right? People make everything viable if they have a will to, you know, change and still serve the customer and make money. I can go on. We don't have time. So last point, we have a problem. We have pretty good quality. One, we can't explain to patients. They can't seem to understand. And therefore, they feel whatever we are charging is very expensive. So you go to a small nursing home or the, you know, JCI accredited, patient doesn't know what is different. They don't know why you're charging so much. Let me go to one. There's another problem which we have. When pressure comes on cost, what do? Do nurse hata do, do housekeeping hata do, do GDS hata do. Hand rub, buy a local cheap one, or remove from five places. Disposable, you know, you reduce them. We don't understand that by cutting these things, we are going to cut corners and compromise quality. Let me give you an example. One, we don't track our data. So in a hospital in Bangalore, we had 10 years of infection rate data, and we went through all details. This is what we found for brain and spine level 7 surgeries. Average length of stay for an infected patient was 11 times more than non-infected patients, 5 days versus 56 days. Bill was 3 lakh for non-infected, 11 lakh for infected, 4 times. You will say, yeah, I have free beds, doesn't matter, patient is paying, mera kya ja raha hai. Here is the thing you need to worry about, because these patients stay in ICU. ICU beds cost much more to invest. You need more talented people to run it, more high-skilled nurses. Okay? But the beauty of this is these patients don't really pay. The discount is 9 times higher that you have to give because you have to settle, right, at the time of discharge. But look at this, gross contribution per day. For infected patients, it's 50,000 per day. For non-infected patients, it's 15,000 per day. So what it means is what one patient in 5 days can give you, you'll need 3 times as much infected patients for a much longer period to give you the same returns. That's penny-wise, pound-foolish. These are input costs of infection control. These are outcomes. These are costs that you will incur because of bad outcomes. So to close the presentation, to be sustainable, one will have to deal with not only economic challenges, but social, political challenges. Without that, we will not be sustainable. We have to be really clear on what our strategy is, who we want to cater to, and build a business model around it. Once we have a business model around it, we have to have a discipline to execute. We will not buy or spend anything on extra curricular because we want to do it or someone else in the neighborhood does it. Then, you know, for everything that is non-core competency, like healthcare at home, like Three Netra, you tie up with other people and you don't have to invest in everything yourself. Last, you have to be ruthless on waste, excess. You have to learn to do more with less. Less capex, less opex, less people, less talent, less infrastructure. Thank you. I don't know if you have time for questions, but I'm here. If you have any questions, I'll be able to take them.